Well, we are now getting everyone situated. When we are in person, this is the time when everyone is taking their seats, but oh, that has been so long ago. So we're glad you're all now getting situated in front of your computers or your phones or whatever. And welcome to Sunday Assembly's 85th Assembly and 16th one online. Sweet 16. So we will be going into our song in a moment, but just to let you know a few little logistics here. The first song will have the lyrics on the screen, but the second one is in the program and the third one too, I believe. And so you can get that program on Meetup or Facebook where the event is. And there's also a link to it in the chat right now. And because of the lag time for our songs, we keep everyone muted. And for the other speakers too, people are muted. But when we're singing, feel free to wave your hands or clap. We love feeling connected that way. And because this is an online assembly, we have some folks here from other assemblies and even from other countries. And so if you are from wherever, feel free to also put that in your name in the where you edit your name, if you would like to do that. And for those of you who might be new to Sunday Assembly is a non-religious, inclusive community. We meet once a month, third Sunday of every month at 11, to hear great speakers. We sing songs and we share stories. And in between these monthly assemblies, we get together for social activities and service projects. And we, our aim is to, you know, build bridges, community, and help everyone to live up to our motto for Sunday Assembly, which is live better, help often, wonder more. And every assembly has a theme. And today's theme is Reconstruction. And let's see, also when we're in person, we always have a media free zone because we do film, or in this case, record our assemblies. And so for virtual assemblies like this, if you do not want to be in that recording, you can disable your video. I don't think very many of us actually show up a whole lot in the video. It's mostly focused on the speaker. And when we're in person, we usually have childcare. We have a separate room for that. And of course, today, childcare is by the most expert person. That would be you. And so now we are ready to kick off with our first song. We're so happy to have Paul Svensson with us. And we've got Drift Away by Mentor Williams. Paul.
Good morning, happy campers. Does everybody have your lyrics to the song? This is yes.
I thought this one was going to be in the screen.
I don't know.
Oh, Laura, could you describe for us? Because that's what was in my notes.
The first, the lyrics for the first song is on the second page of the program.
Oh, okay.
It's in the program.
Sorry about that, folks.
That's my mistake.
I suspect some of you know this, and you'll figure out the chorus anyway, because that's what we do. 18 months of sitting in a room by myself leading singing. So at least look like you're singing along, but I would really encourage you to sing. It's good for the soul. Here we go. Day after day, I'm more confused. I look for the light through the pouring rain. No, it's a game that I hate to lose. But I'm feeling the strain. Ain't it a shame? Oh, give me the beat, boys, to free my soul. Wanna get lost in your rock and roll and drift away. Sing it again now. Give me the beat, boys, free my soul. I wanna get lost in your rock and roll and drift away. Beginning to think that I'm wasting time. I don't understand the things I do. The world outside looks so unkind. But get lost in your rock and roll and drift away. Oh, give me the beat, boys, free my soul. I wanna get lost in your rock and roll and drift away. And when my mind is free, you know a melody can move me. Guitar's coming through to soothe me. Thanks for the joy that you've given me. I want you to know I believe in your song. Rhythm, rhyme, and harmony. You help me along. Making me strong, here we go. And give me the beat, boys, free my soul. Wanna get lost in your rock and roll and drift away. Oh, give me the beat, boys, free my soul. I wanna get lost in your rock and roll and drift away. Do it once more. Give me the beat, boys, free my soul. Wanna get lost in your rock and roll and drift away. Good singing.
Thank you. And I'm co-emceeing today with Lynn. So I think she's going to do some of our life happens here.
Yes, I think I managed to unmute myself, and I'm going to be reading off some life happens events. Paul and Wendy have moved to their new house with all of their boxes. A multi-week process that's finally over. Brigitte got a new job. She's the office manager for a small office, and she's very excited about the change after working many years in her current job. Lalia has a big doctor's appointment to check out her spine in 11 days. The family is nervous about it. Then they'll fly back to Philadelphia in December, right before Christmas, for final x-rays and make some big decisions about the timing of her major spine surgery that will be 6 months of recovery. Val Norton just got back from a choral workshop in Santa Fe. They sang while masked and vaccinated for a masked and vaccinated audience. It was great. And that's all, folks.
Wonderful, thank you. And so that's part of our sharing our lives with each other. We can always follow up and ask each other questions about those things at the end of assembly. We have time in our chat room. And the other thing that we do with Help Often is various service projects. And not too long ago, Sunday Assembly has adopted a beach at Mission Bay, and a really nice group of folks turned out to clean that up. There were some wonderful pictures posted on Facebook for that. And we were thinking that, you know, cleanups right now is really a perfect outdoor COVID safe Help Often activity. And so I would like to invite you now and anytime throughout assembly today, if you think of it, to think of a place around San Diego County that could use being cleaned up, that we could bring out a little group of folks, we'll put it on Meetup when we do, to clean up that spot. And so if you have an idea for a place, we've got Alexis's living room. So no, it must be outdoors. So put that in the chat, and we'll have some of us will take some notes of that, and we'll put that into consideration for, you know, to look at the logistics of it. And you might see that very spot show up on a Meetup soon. So thank you for doing that. And so now we'll move into our next activity, which is for today's reading. It's going to be Neila by Marge Piercy, and that poem will be read by Victoria De La Torre.
Hey everyone. I'm excited to read this all for you. All right. The hinge of the year, the great gates opening, and then slowly, slowly closing on us. I always imagine those gates hanging over the ocean, fiery over the stone gray waters of evening. We cast what we must change about ourselves onto the waters flowing to the sea. The sins, errors, bad habits, whatever you call them, dissolve. When I was little, I cried out, I want. Older, I feel less important, a worker bee in the hive of history, miles of hard labor to make my sweetness. The gates are closing, the light is failing. I kneel before what I love, imploring that it may live. So much breaks, wears down, fails in us. We must forgive our broken promises, their sharp shards in our hands. Thank you.
Thank you.
And it's my turn again. I have the pleasure of introducing today's speaker. Fred Hocker is an archaeologist and historian, currently the director of research at the Vasa Museum in Stockholm. He was formerly the Yamini Professor of Nautical Archaeology at Texas A&M University. He has excavated and reconstructed shipwrecks from the Middle Ages, Renaissance, and early modern periods in the United States, the Netherlands, Turkey, Denmark, and Sweden. And most important of all, he's a 1979 graduate of Loudoun County High School in Leesburg, Virginia, where I graduated 2 years earlier. Welcome, Fred.
Thank you, Lynn. Lynn also didn't mention that I also went out with her for a little while when I was in high school, which was a great pleasure, I'll say. So I'm very happy to be asked to give a talk for you, and I'm looking forward to this. And I think if I recall correctly, I should get this done in about 20 minutes, right? Yep. And I'm going to attempt to share my screen. This worked before. There we are. And what I'd like to talk to you about today is part of my job as an archaeologist and historian working with the find of Vasa, a Swedish warship that sank on its maiden voyage in 1628. And I'm not going to talk that much about the ship itself, but more about the people who were on board, and how we go about trying to figure out who they were. This is a research theme. We have six big research themes at the museum. And this one goes by the name of Who Are You? Trying to get closer to the people who were there when the ship sank. And part of this is talking about what can we know about people who have been dead for nearly 400 years. The ship itself was built in 1626, 1627, and was badly designed. And so it basically sank during the commissioning ceremony. And its entire operational career lasted about 30 minutes and about 1,200 yards. The cold, polluted waters of Stockholm Harbor preserved the ship very well. And so in 1961, it was possible to raise the ship largely intact and even refloat it briefly. And here it is moving into a dry dock, floating on its own keel after 333 years underwater. After it was raised, a team of 12 archaeologists spent 5 months excavating the interior of the ship and recovering nearly 30,000 different objects. Basically everything that had been on board, except for the cannon, most of which had been salvaged after the ship sank, and some of the very fragile organic material. But a surprising amount of survival of what we would normally consider fairly fragile material, such as cloth, even paper in some cases. The ship itself, just as a quick introduction, is completely reconstructed now, at least the hull and the lower masts. It's 69 meters long, and I think that works out to just about 230 feet, about 12 meters or close to 40 feet wide, about 60 feet high at the stern. And in service, it weighed a total of about 1,300 tons. And what's most remarkable is that a little bit more than 98% of the original structure of the ship survives. It's essentially an intact building. And before COVID, we were the most visited, it was the centerpiece of the most visited maritime museum in the world, with about 1.5 million visitors annually from all over the world. What I'm going to talk about today, however, is not the ship so much, but the crew and what we can learn about them. We have some historical data that tells us what the crew should have been. The manning requirements for that year suggest that Vasa, which is the second item on this list, should have had a crew made up of 133 mariners who sailed the ship, plus 300 soldiers, knechter, who would man the guns and fight the ship. The soldiers were not on board because you only took them on board if you were actually going into battle, because otherwise they were useless mouths you had to feed. And so in this case, only the sailors were on board. We don't know exactly how many actually turned up on the day, but we do know that they weren't alone. And so when we look at the people on board, we don't really talk about the crew. They're a part of a bigger group that we would refer to as a community. And that includes people who were not technically part of the crew, like the carpenters. They were employees of the shipyard who built the ship. They were along, as you could say, the service contract. There were two cats that were part of the crew. Their job was to keep the rat population in check. And an unknown number of women and children who were part of the shipboard community. Some were there just as guests for the day. We know that from historical records. But others were probably going to stay with the ship as long as it was in home waters. About 30 of these people died, including women and children, and I'm afraid to say, the two cats. A Swedish warship in this period had women on board, usually, as long as you were in domestic waters. The regulations for the Navy stated specifically, there shall be no whores on board our ships, and by this they meant unmarried women. But wives may accompany their husbands as long as the ship is in the stream or the archipelago, that is in Swedish waters, and it is not expected to meet the enemy. Although if you suddenly encountered the enemy, I don't know how much effort was made to get the women and children ashore if you just put them in a safe place. If we talk about the people connected to the ship, there are several different contexts we could talk about that are related. There are those who are on board, but they're also the people in the shipyard that built the ship and set it up, the people in the countryside who produced all the raw materials to build the ship, such as the timber or the hemp for the rope, as well as the families that provided the men who became the crew, and then even people abroad who were producing both people and resources to put the ship into operation. In this case, we're just going to look at the people who were on board, what we call Voss's people. Trigger warning, I should have given you there is one photo of human remains here. And in this case, we do have the remains of some of the people who were on board, about half of the people who died when the ship sank. Those are 11 or 12 well-defined individuals inside the ship. Generally speaking, human remains found on this ship are found as discrete skeletons, not just as random bones. There are a few, but mostly we can identify individuals. Plus another four or five people outside the ship in where the stern collapsed. They were in the stern cabins and their remains ended up with the remains of the furniture. Plus a few bones from at least two other individuals who don't have substantial remains. Most of these people were on the upper decks in the ship. Almost all of these remains are found near the ladders. They're clearly trying to get out of the ship at the moment that it was sinking, but it sank so quickly that they were unable to get out. And so these are where these people were found. You can see they have names. These have been assigned to the skeletons in order so that we have a way to keep them straight as individuals. They were originally just given letters by the archaeologists who excavated the ship. In the 1990s, an osteologist who studied the remains decided that was dehumanizing. And so she assigned them names based on the Swedish radio code. We don't use Whiskey Tango Foxtrot, we use names to spell things. And so you may note here that there's at least one woman, Beata, otherwise most of the skeletons are male. but we'll come back to that. And the lower decks of the ship, there are only really two people who seem to have died there. One probably because he was guarding the gunpowder, and the other seems to have been someone who fell down to that level from higher up in the ship. And if you want to add in this, ask me in the chat or in the question how I know that. In summary, these are mostly male. There are 13 that are in the age 16 to 50 plus years old, although most are in their 20s and 30s. They range from 160 to 176 centimeters tall. That's about 5'2" to about 5'8". But they average around 5'5", 5'5½". There are two female skeletons, adult female skeletons in their 20s or 30s. And they're both average height for the time, which is around 5'2", 5'3". We also have a single arm bone from a child less than 10 years old. It's in very poor condition, it's incomplete, and so it's quite difficult to judge exactly what the age is. It's hard to judge age from long bones at that age, young people. If you have a skull, you can tell from the teeth which ones have erupted approximately how old a person was. We've been analyzing these people, not just through the normal osteological measures of looking at the bones, but also some chemical and other analysis to try to figure out their medical history. We've done DNA analysis of most of the skeletons, and we've succeeded in extracting both mitochondrial DNA, which is a small portion of your DNA that you inherit unchanged from your mother, and it's a way to trace descent. And then we have succeeded in extracting a more complete nuclear DNA profile from some individuals. If you're interested, the best place to get DNA where it lasts the longest in your skeleton, it used to be thought was your teeth, but in recent years, it's become clear that the place in your body that your DNA lasts the longest is in something called the petrous bone. That's the part of your skull where your ear canal goes in. And that's the best place to get DNA. And so that's the, in the photograph on the right, that's the bone that's been cut out of this partial skull. In order to reconstruct who these people were, we can use some conventional techniques that have been used for years in the forensic world. For example, reconstructing their appearance. This has, by the way, relatively little scientific value for early modern people. It's mostly of public value for communication purposes. There's not a lot we learn by knowing what somebody looked like, although it's sometimes interesting to hear what the visitors to the museum think they can see in a reconstructed face. Oh, he looks very Finnish. Oh, he must be a Dane, because people in Scandinavia have very clear ideas about how people from other countries look, most of which turn out not to have a lot of basis in scientific fact. This type of reconstruction was pioneered almost a century and a quarter ago in Russia, after people discovered that what makes you look like you is the shape of your skull. The thickness of the soft tissue on top of the skull is more or less the same for everybody. And so if you can reconstruct the musculature and the skin, you can get a fairly accurate idea of what somebody looks like. And this is used to identify murder victims, for example. And historically, reconstructions of this type successfully get an identification about 60% of the time. So there's a better than even chance that if you'd known this person when he was alive, you would recognize him from his face. What's interesting is you still get a good identification even if you get the ethnicity wrong. That if we had reconstructed this as a person of African descent, for example, we probably still would have been able to get an identification, which suggests that ethnicity is not one of the things that we use to tell each other apart. We also can look at a person's possessions that they had with them at the time to see something. And so this is this particular gentleman that I just showed you, who was an older fellow, probably in his late 40s into his 50s, was carrying a musket and a lantern and was guarding the gunpowder store. I tend to think of him as the guard in the dark. And the lantern actually has a burn mark on the underside from where it tipped over as the ship was sinking. It might be an indication of just how long it took the ship to sink. We've successfully reconstructed the faces of six people this way. Here you can see four of them, all adult males. We also have one female, Beata, who we successfully have been able to reconstruct. And one interesting person, Gustav. Now, Gustav is a very good object lesson in what we can and can't know about people of the past. Archaeologically, we have a reasonably good chance of determining from your bones your sex, basically whether you're male or female, although we now understand that that's not a binary choice, even biologically, it's a spectrum. And so what we can tell by looking at your bones, by the shape of your skull, the shape of your pelvis, is we can get one of five possible results, really, or five ranges. Male, probably male. I have no idea. Probably female and, yeah, female. And most people statistically fall towards the ends of that spectrum. It's an inverse bell curve. But there are a substantial number of people whose biological sexual characteristics are not very well defined. And we all know people like that, people who have what we call androgynous features. But we do have well-established cues that we pick up that let us determine from looking at a person, regardless of their hairstyle or how they're dressed, and often that we'll look and say, oh, that person's female or that person's male. What we're really talking about is sex. We cannot determine archaeologically gender. Gender has two components. It's who you think you are. There's no way to recover that archaeologically. It's just no way to tell. That's in your mind. It's hardwired into your brain, and only you know the answer to that. And if you don't write it down for an historian to read, we'll never know. Now, how you present yourself to the world, we might be able to figure that out if we find your clothing, for example. And you come from a culture where men and women dress differently. And most Western European cultures, that is the case. And most Western European cultures operate on the principle of male-female binary organization of society. Other cultures in other parts of the world don't. You might be interested to know. Gustav was initially identified by the first osteologist who looked at the remains as female. That osteologist was a man. The second osteologist who looked at him in the 1990s, a woman, decided that Gustav was a man. And so this reconstruction was done of Gustav as a man. And then the latest osteologist to look at Gustav thinks Gustav is actually Yoro, a woman. And the nuclear DNA confirms that this person has the right chromosomes to be considered female. However, the facial characteristics are not distinctive. The lower part of the face has very distinctly male characteristics. The upper part of this face have characteristics that we would normally consider female. Unfortunately, there are no objects associated with this skeleton to tell us how this person defined his or her or their identity. So we're left by saying biologically female, but that's about all we can tell you. Another case of how we sometimes get turned around in this is looking at another person. And now I'm going to give you two quick case studies on two people we can say quite a lot about based on a combination of their remains and their possessions. And I call this first one the wrong trousers, because I'm going to start with the possessions. These are textiles. We have quite a lot of textiles that were found associated with the skeleton. And these textiles were originally reconstructed as a pair of trousers, or breeches actually, short trousers. And you can see on the left side, the gathers along what is the waistline of the garment. And in fact, these fragments were used to reconstruct a set of clothing for a typical Vasa sailor, this fairly creepy, I think, mannequin, which is a pastiche of garments found all over the ship. And in fact, the trousers are a pastiche of fragments from several different places that don't all belong together. So this fragment was used for the front left leg. This fragment was used for the front right leg, but they don't come from the same place. They don't originally belong together. And you'll note they're two different colors. We have a major project going looking at all of the clothing remains from the ship, which is the largest collection of ordinary people's everyday clothing from any one single use context in the world. This is the best way to know how ordinary Swedes dressed. And we're looking at over 5,000 textile fragments and over 6,000 leather fragments from shoes, boots, mittens, and gloves. And so if we actually piece all the fragments of this garment back together, way too long to be a pair of trousers. It's about 85 centimeters, which is about 34 inches, maybe 32 inches, something like that. And so once you put it all together, it's too long to be a pair of trousers. Trousers stopped at the knee in this period. It's possible to do this by comparing distinct discontinuities in the weave, matching up seams and that sort of thing. And if we look at where this was found and the skeletal remains, we get a very interesting story. We have the black boxes here represent individual bones that we now know from DNA analysis all belong to the same person. And we have one group of bones here that are all the lower half of a skeleton, the legs and feet. And we have a second group that are the upper half, rib cage, arms, skull. And they're separated because there was a cannon there originally. And so this person probably died lying across the cannon and the body separated into two parts and the jacket kept the upper half all together and the other garment kept the lower half together. What's interesting is that long garment that's not a pair of trousers was found with the lower half of a skeleton. The skeleton was identified immediately as female, that this is Beata. However, the archaeologists who excavated the site simply assumed that everybody on board the ship was male, and so they identified the garment as trousers because it had a waistband, without bothering to look at the fact that the bones they found this garment draped on belonged to a woman. They simply assumed that everybody on board was male. And in fact, if you look on the right, what they used as the right front leg of that mannequin is in fact one of the sleeves to the jacket for this woman, for Beata. And it's possible to reconstruct her in quite a lot of detail. So I'd like you to meet Beata. Her bones were found commingled with those of a male about 10 years older than she is. And because most women would be on board as wives of men, there's a possibility that she is the wife of that other skeleton, whom we call Caesar. We can see that she's about 20 or 25 years old. She's about 5'2", which is average height for a woman. From DNA, we know she had brown eyes. We also can see that she was malnourished. She had poor nutrition. She had low copper and zinc values, which suggests she probably suffered from anemia or chronic diarrhea. She was wearing a reddish brown jacket of the same cut as you see in this painting of a Dutch fishwife and a dark skirt, actually very similar to this woman. Her shoes were very nicely made shoes that had been repaired, and she had probably bought them secondhand. And she was wearing an embroidered shawl or bonnet because across the shoulders of her jacket, under a microscope, we can see lint from silk, individual colored silk fibers, which are probably from the embroidery of what she was wearing over the jacket. And we think it might be possible if we map those carefully enough to reconstruct what that embroidered pattern was. And this is a facial reconstruction of the somewhat malnourished Beata. Now, in other cases, we don't have a skeleton. We only have the possessions. This is a distribution map of all of the textile finds, all the clothing finds from the upper gun decks, which is where most of them were. And on the uppermost deck, most of these are either loose finds lying on the deck or they're directly associated with human remains. But we do have an area in the bow on both, which is full of chests and barrels and sacks of people's personal possessions, where they'd been stowed there for the initial part of the voyage. Now, sometimes that context alone will tell us something. So this is a lower deck in the ship where there aren't very many finds, but we do have a chest with clothing in it found in a small compartment. And because the clothing was in a chest full of tools, we know they belonged to a carpenter. In another case nearby, we have a chest full of personal possessions that include clothing that also include a linstock, a thing you use for firing a cannon. And this is in a compartment that was only accessible if you were one of the master gunners on board. And so that's probably the master gunner's possessions. He's somebody we know from historical records, so we might be able to link his possessions to what he did before he got joined also. In other cases, all we have is a chest of belongings from this big mass in the bow. And so in this particular chest, we have enough finds that we believe we can reconstruct a person to whom we've given the fictive name of Balthasar, which was a not uncommon name in Sweden at the time, Balthasar. Those of you with biblical backgrounds may have heard that name before. And those include what was found in that chest were all the things he thought he needed to take to sea with him. It includes stuff for cooking and eating, a pot to cook in, a bucket to serve food in. This is the normal thing that you serve food in if you weren't one of the officers, as well as bowls and spoons for eating in wood. The fact that he ate with wood suggests he's not one of the officers who dined in the stern, usually on ceramic or metal plates and bowls. But he has very nice shoes. There's a very nice pair of shoes in this cask. And we can see they have a stacked up heel, which was a very new fashion in Sweden at the time, very up to the minute. And it's the more expensive way to make a shoe that we know of the two main ways. So this is a guy who's spending some money on his shoes. And keep in mind, he's wearing another pair of shoes. So this is a guy who has enough money to own a spare pair of shoes. And these are relatively new, we can see. He also, and of course, accessories make the outfit. And so he has accessories that tell us a lot. So there are a lot of buttons associated with the clothing. These you can see are cast pewter with a little brass wire eye. And the thing on the right that looks like a toothpick is called a point. It's a little bit of rolled brass sheet covered in gold leaf. And these decorated the laces that you used that tied your jacket to your trousers. You didn't use a belt to hold your trousers up. You tied your jacket to your trousers. And so your jacket acted as the suspenders. He also had a belt, but you wore a belt to hang stuff on, not to hold your trousers up. And this is a sword belt. It has the suspension gear for carrying a rapier. And next to the to this barrel, not in it, was the scabbard and the grip for a rapier. So this is somebody who owned and would have carried a sword, which really you were only allowed to do if you were considered a gentleman. He also had a fair amount of money in his chest, 295 copper coins, or next almost 40 pounds weight of copper. And that is not maybe as much money as it might sound like, but it was worth about $9, the Swedish unit of currency at the time, the equivalent of 2 months' pay for an ordinary sailor. So a sixth of his annual pay, if this was an ordinary sailor, it would be a smaller proportion if he was someone of higher rank. So it's one of the largest coin hoards or groups of coins that we have from the ship. Also, he has a set of clothing, 584 fragments, seven different types of woolen fabrics, two different types of bast fiber, that's either linen or hemp, and even some tablet woven silk. These are his trousers or breeches, and these are in fact breeches. We often call them the lurid purple trousers because they are in fact dyed purple. They're actually what you call plum brown or tannet. And it's been possible to we can see that they're made of wool in this color called tannet. They have an interlining to stiffen them to make them stand out of waxed linen. It still has the wax in it, material called dvelk, and then lined with linen. And we've been able to put enough of the fragments back together to see what the style is. And these are a little bit old fashioned for 1628. They're the style of short, full breeches that was common about 20 years earlier or 15 years earlier. This is an original pair from the 1620s in a museum in London. And these are actually a style that goes back into the 16th century. The ones you see in Shakespeare plays where the guy looks like he's wearing a pair of beach balls that don't quite come down to his knees. So very fancy. They're made out of good quality material. And in fact, they're decorated with tablet woven silk bands sewn along the seams. similar to the kinds of silk stripes you have on the side of your tux trousers. And these are very finely made, probably in multiple colors of silk. Very fancy. He had a doublet or a short jacket with a fairly tightly fitting body, but loose sleeves that were open along the front seam so you'd be able to see his shirt. It's very fashionable. That fashion had just come in about 2 or 3 years earlier, so he's up to the minute there. What's interesting is we can reconstruct how big he was from the garment. It's well enough preserved. We can see he was about 5'11" tall, which would have made him a giant. Being 5'11" in Sweden in 1628 is like being 6'6" in America today. Very tall guy. And so meet Balthazar, an exceptionally tall man. Can't tell you how old he is, of course. All of his possessions are of good quality. Some of his stuff is very current fashion, his shoes and his jacket. His breeches, he liked older fashion. If you look at any society, if you look at what people are wearing today, you're going to look at the past 30 years of fashion, because there are plenty of people who don't modernize their dress. They like, they like that leisure suit, you know, from the 70s, so they keep wearing it. But the fact that he had that much money and a full second set of clothing and shoes suggests he was a person of means, and the fact that he had a sword belt and thus a sword marks him as a gentleman. So even though without his with only his possessions, without any parts of Balthazar himself, we can say a lot about him. We can also say he's not any of our skeletons. He's another person entirely. Now, the next trick is to figure out who he might have been, what rank, what role he might have had on board the crew. That's the next phase of the research, and that's somewhat more complicated. And in closing, I'll just introduce you to our research team. I'm just the front man for this band. All this research is being done by a lot of other people, textile experts, shoe experts, historians, I'm the archaeologist, photographers, people who are really good with computer data analysis. And this is being funded by a number of foundations. Our textile research alone is funded by 3 different organizations as a fairly major project. That's what we can say about somebody, even someone long gone. What we could say about you, if we could find enough of your stuff, or if we could find you, what we might be able to say about you 400 years hence. Thank you.
Thank you, Fred. That was fascinating. Thank you so much. And I'll remind folks that we will have an opportunity at the end of assembly today to have more informal discussion and ask questions. I have jotted down a few that I want to ask. So thank you so much. So we're going to go back to Paul for our sing-along with that fun song, When I Die.
Okay, well, I should have had a Swedish sea shanty. I apologize for not doing that in advance.
It's okay, there aren't any.
I figured there probably weren't. So we'll just sing a fun little song about death. How would that be? What I'd like you to do, since we don't have the words, you can look all you want, but they're not anywhere. Sort of on purpose, because it's more fun this way. We'll do it old school. So the song goes like this. They may bury my body when I die, when I die. They may bury my body when I die. Near some graveside I'll be found, simply rotting in the... And they may bury my body when I die. So I'll give you the first line, you sing it with me and do the little echo, then we sing it again, do the little echo, then I'll sing a thing and leave the word off, and then we'll sing it all together. Got it? They may burn my body when I die. They may burn my body when I die. As the fiery furnace flashes, I'll be nothing more than... If they burn my body when I die. Oh, you sound great. They may use my body when I die, when I die. They may use my body when I die. As the doctors ply their arts, I'll be in a million. If they use my body when I die, when I die, they may freeze my body when I die. They may freeze my body when I die. Though I may be well mistaken, I would hope to Rhea. If they freeze my body when I die, they may eat my body when I die. When I die, yum, yum, yum. They may eat my body when I die. As the zombie horde remains, they'll be hankering for. If they eat my body when I die, when I die, I prefer to never die at all, die at all. I prefer to never die at all. Cheating death is such a rarity, it would take a sing-you to permit we never die at all, die at all. They may bury my body when I die, when I die. They may bury my body when I die. Near some graveside I'll be found, simply rotting in the. If they bury my body when I die, when I die.
Thank you, Paul. That was
fun. Oh, you're so welcome. You're so welcome.
Even without being able to hear all the callbacks, it was still, that was cool.
Oh, I could hear them. I could hear them in my mind.
That's great. Thank you. So as part of our sharing life together and knowing learning about each other's lives and stories, today's personal moment will be with Brigitte Sampson.
There we go. Almost can be a good word. A long time ago, when I was 14 or 15, I used to be part of a rowing team. There were so many wonderful things about the sport. One of them was a place where we used to practice and compete. Beautiful little river, bordered with lush green fields, sometimes an estate home, pastures with moderately curious cows looking at you in your skinny little boat going by. This was back in Europe where I grew up. One of the other things I really liked were the peacefulness of the water, the quiet but sharp noise of the oars' blades dropping in the water, and the swooshing sound of the crew boat gliding on the still water. I used to train in a crew of four, sometimes two, and also competed as and trained in a single scull. If you have never gotten a close-up look at these type of rowing boat, they're very long and very narrow to reduce drag and improve speed. These boats are designed for speed, and so is your seat. The body of the boat is not much wider than your own behind. The seat is narrow, set on a sort of rail, and your feet are bolted into place with a foot stretcher. This allows you to push back and get maximum propulsion when you pull your oars through the water. The long, narrow boat is, of course, unstable. Your oars and outriggers will allow you to keep your balance. Rowing in one of these is a rhythmic, precise, neat, beautiful movement sanctioned by the soft sound of the boat on the water. It was February on a weekday, and I had decided to go to the rowing club. And train alone. The winters in that area are not severe, but nevertheless can get pretty chilly. Think Northern California or Oregon in February on a cloudy day. I get into my sweatpants, my sweatshirt, a beanie hat to keep warm, and warm socks and tennis shoes. I get my single scull boat to the floating dock, set the boat on the water, get in, and push the boat away from the shore with a single efficient push. It's a weekday, so there is not a lot of activity on the river. It seems to be all mine. I'm rowing away, enjoying the view, the quiet, the time alone. The river is wider at certain points, a little narrower at other points. Sometimes it's opening up on a small backyard, sometimes a wide open field, sometimes a lot of wild bushes and tangled greenery. I go upriver and eventually, satisfied by the distance, I decided it's time to turn around and start going back. In order to turn around, you need to keep one oar flat on the water to keep balance, and then use the other oar to push and turn the boat around. Somehow, my moving oar did not fall in the water at the proper angle and slipped off the surface. And in a second, before I could even realize what happened, my boat has flipped me over and I'm broadly thrown in the cold water. Even though I know how to swim, I'm suddenly trying to find my breath, like now, suffocating as the cold water soaks my clothes and my shoes and are feeling heavier and heavier. Surprise, this is not even the word I'm looking for. I'm pawing at the water, wondering how to get myself and the boat to the shore when I can't even get my breathing under control or estimate how long I can swim like this. I look around, and I'm at those points where the river is wider, a distance away, I can see a small road, a cafe, and some parked cars. Now I'm starting to begin to worry. The shore is pretty far from me, and even though I'm not really swimming, but panting and getting heavier and pawing at the water, by the second my soaked clothes and shoes feels like they're dragging me down. It dawns on me that I may be in a bad situation. And that is when I noticed that the people I had seen earlier, messing with the Zodiac near the dock, not far from those parked cars, were lifeguards on a training session. I was lucky enough to flip into the water in sight of training lifeguards. They spot me pretty quickly, and I instantly know that they're going to come to get me. My beginning sense of panic is leaving me. I am so relieved. They fish me out of the water, throw a warm blanket on me, grab my boat by the outrigger, retrieve my oars, and off we motor back to the club. If I remember well, this had happened so fast. They marveled at how lucky it was that it happened when I was inside. I'm pretty sure I did the same. Was it that night, or the next day, or even much later? I only then thought I could have drowned. I almost drowned, I suppose. Sometimes almost is a good word. Thank you. I'm glad to be here.
We're so glad you're here.
Thank you.
Wonderful serendipity there with the lifeguards.
Definitely.
All right.
Okay, it's my turn again. And I am going to now attempt to share my screen. Bear with me. I'm not a pro at this, like Fred is. Okay, that's the problem. Let's see. There, whoops. Well, you just missed my title slide of Reconstruction, but that's okay. I am new to this role of an MC address, but it's exciting to be wearing a different hat. When the board first learned that Dr. Hocker would be our speaker for today, we thought he might talk to us about the history of how the Vasa was pulled from the sea 333 years after it sank and then restored. So we were thinking the theme for this assembly could be restoration. I had some immediate thoughts about how I could build an MC address around that theme of restoration and offered to try my hand at MCing for the first time, as long as I could have some help. Kristen, an experienced MC for Sunday Assembly San Diego, volunteered to co-host, so I was on. When Dr. Hocker indicated his topic could be about the work being done to reconstruct the lives of the people who were on the Vossa when it sank, we went with that, and a new theme was chosen, reconstruction. Very briefly, I thought, I volunteered to talk about restoration, but reconstruction? I don't know. But fairly quickly, it dawned on me that I could begin my MC address by talking about the similarities and differences between these two nouns. So here goes. I'm going to provide a little bit of commentary and a bunch of images on the themes of restoration and reconstruction. They are processes that have some things in common, but they are not synonyms. Restoration and reconstruction both involve dealing with something that has existed in the past, but the kind of processes being undertaken and the outcomes being sought are different for each. With restoration, a process is undertaken to return something to a prior or healthier condition. This can be an active or a passive process. Reconstruction, in contrast, is an active process and has two primary meanings. One definition has to do with repairing or rebuilding something that has been damaged or destroyed. This may be similar to restoration, but perhaps involves a more intensive recreating process that may result in a different outcome than the original state of the object or being. The rebuilt thing may need to be different in some important way. The other meaning of reconstruction has to do with figuring out how some prior event or circumstance happened or developed. And that's what we heard Fred talk about earlier. But let's look at restoration first, just briefly. When I think of restoration, I think of people sleeping at night to restore their body's readiness to live another day. I see people taking breaks during their workday to restore their focus and their energy. I think of people engaging in meaningful conversation and communication to restore their sense of connection to others, or to return or build goodwill in their relationships. I picture old pieces of furniture or old cars being returned to their prior states. I see paintings being carefully cleaned so their original colors emerge again. I see sand replenishment programs along a beach to restore sand that had washed out to sea. I see new forest growth where wildfires once raged. I see wetlands and other habitats being restored. I see people going to rehab to aid their recovery from an injury or an addictive behavior. Restoration seems like a part of everyone's day in small ways, like sleeping and taking a break from work or activities. And it seems like a natural part of overall life as we recover from big and small illnesses, injuries, mishaps, and setbacks or problems. When I think of reconstruction, I see a different set of images and have a different set of thoughts. I see surgical reconstruction after a mastectomy, or severe burns, or following other kinds of severe injuries to bones, joints, or soft tissue. I think of natural disasters like hurricanes, floods, mudslides, wildfires, and tornadoes, or the damage done by more man-made disasters like war or a bridge collapse, even though this picture may not have occurred following a natural, may have occurred in the context of a natural disaster. Some bridge collapses are clearly man-made problems. When I think of reconstruction, I also see Following such disasters, I see cleanups in neighborhoods and major repair work on roads and bridges. I see repair work on electrical infrastructure. when I think of Reconstruction, I see buildings being rebuilt. I also think of police attempting to reconstruct what happened at a crime scene, or investigators reconstructing the cause of an airline crash, in which case they may also be literally reconstructing the plane from its debris. Finally, being the psychologist that I am, I also think of reconstruction as something that happens in individual lives following some kind of life-altering event or circumstance. Many of us will experience this kind of reconstruction on a personal level. We may have to reconstruct or redefine who we are, how we're going to live in big or small ways, and perhaps what provides us with meaning. This kind of reconstruction becomes necessary following things like the death of a loved one, divorce or the end of an important interpersonal relationship, job loss or chronic unemployment, serious physical injury, serious mental illness, or other kinds of personal trauma. Some degree of personal reconstruction may also be necessary during mass events like a pandemic, economic downturns, political upheaval, and the natural disasters we were already talking about, and other kinds of collective trauma. But the beauty of being human is that as a species, we are individually and collectively capable of both restoration and reconstruction. Our brains allow us to adapt to changing environments and circumstances. We can collectively rebuild damaged roads and bridges, replant burned out forests, and restore our wetlands. We can affect political and cultural changes in our towns, cities, states, and countries. And as individuals, we can learn new ways of thinking, feeling, and behaving, when to do so is necessary or desirable. Such reconstructive change can be extremely difficult and slow, both culturally and as individuals. And some people may have a more limited capacity to make reconstructive changes in themselves than others have. But for most people, reconstructing their thought patterns, sense of self, and short-term goals, and where they find meaning in life is possible in those situations where it becomes necessary or desirable. And there are mental health professionals and mutual help groups that can assist in this process when outside help would be of help. In fact, psychotherapy might be thought of as embodying restoration and or reconstruction, depending upon the reason it is sought and the goals each individual has for themselves. Humans' capacity for both restoration and reconstruction are worthy of celebration. Celebrate life. There are times to focus on restoration or reconstruction in our personal lives, but sometimes it's okay if the only thing you did today was breathe and maybe find some beauty around you. All from San Diego. And that is that for the MC address.
Thank you.
I only got lost once, so.
No, that was great. That I thought of so many things during that. Feel like there's so many things in the world right now that need reconstruction and restoration. And I think you've planned a breakout group for us, right?
I have. We're going to break into small groups now of about 4 to 6 people for a brief discussion period. That will be about 8 minutes. Everybody will be assigned to a group and then given the option to join that group or not. We hope that you'll join the small group, but you can opt out. The small groups will close automatically at the end of the time period, and everyone will return to the whole group for the remainder of the assembly. In our small groups, we will discuss the following question. Have you ever needed to reconstruct parts of your life or your sense of self following some change in your circumstances? And now, Laura is going to send us off to our small groups.
When we were planning this, we thought that 8 minutes was like totally sufficient for these breakout groups. And in our group, I feel like we barely touched the surface. So if anyone would like to, if you had anything that you would like to share with the larger group, we invite you to put that in the chat, and I'm going to open the chat so that I can see it. And I know in our group, everyone had something, the concept of reconstruction resonated in big ways with moving and loved ones dying and how life is after that. So if anyone wants to put any salient points in the chat, no obligation, you don't have to, if you want to. Let's give that a moment in case anyone writes anything there. And also, you know, as we heard today from Brigitte with her personal moment, we love to share stories of our lives with each other. It just kind of helps us all get a different sense of each other and build community. And if you heard an inkling of an idea during those breakout groups that you think, oh, that would make a really good story to share with the whole group. If you could message me any way that you want through the chat or private message or text, whether it's your own story, or even if you heard of someone else's story that you thought was really interesting, what we do with these personal moments is you don't have to be the one to read it. It can be somebody else reading it. And we kind of work with you to like curate it, you know, get it the appropriate length and whatnot. So it's not like something you have to do alone, but just putting that out there, it's always it's an ongoing work to collect these wonderful stories and have people share with folks, because I think people find it very rewarding when we hear from each other. So please reach out to me if you have an idea. So hang on a moment, I want to make sure I've checked my notes here. So we have all talked about a lot today. And as we do each month, we will have a short moment of reflection now. So we'll just have a moment of silence. All right. Thank you everyone for that. We now have a few announcements. And since I'm guessing that a lot of the breakout groups had a lot to say, I'll remind everyone that, and we do have some things in the chat about reconstructing can feel like starting over and that it can be scary. We have, as our first announcement, Taco Tuesdays. So that's on Tuesdays at 6 o'clock, Zoom chatting, just to check in and talk. And you can always pick up one of these breakout questions if you want and continue it. So we invite you to do that. And let's see, I think, Lynn, you've got our second announcement.
I do. So Taco Tuesdays are obviously on Tuesdays every week at 6. But we do Scattergories on the second and fourth Thursday of each month, also on Zoom, and they start at 7 o'clock. It's informal, it's fun. So anybody's welcome to join in on those game nights. We also have started something called Roaming Restaurants, and we've had 2 outings and are looking to do more of those over time. So we invite anybody who knows of a great place to have a meal with a group of people to get that message to any of the organizers And we will see about making reservations and creating a meetup for your favorite restaurant. Yesterday, we had our second bowling outing. The first one I was on the East Coast for, so I couldn't attend. But yesterday we had a small group. I think the first group was quite large, but good time had by everybody. And that will probably be another event to be scheduled again in the near future.
Yeah. And another upcoming meetup next Sunday, August 22nd at 4:30 p.m. One of the activities that I kind of took up during pandemic is croquet. And we did one meetup a few weeks ago at Balboa Park. And the one this coming Sunday will be at Liberty Station and will be, you know, it's very proper sport. I can't really do the accent or anything, but you know, your linen outfits, they're optional. No, really, jeans, shorts, whatever you want. You don't have to know how to play croquet. We set up a course. We'll have one game or two, depending on how many people there are. It's kind of a fun way just to hang out and talk. So you can check out all these events on Meetup. And back to you, Lynn.
Okay, so many of you were able to come to the venue on the 4th of July to enjoy the incredible view of the fireworks happening over the bay. And that was so much fun that we've decided to do another social event at our venue. It's going to be on Saturday, October 28th at 6 p.m. We're calling it Pizza and Games. No idea what we're going to be doing or what we'll be eating, but I think it might be pizza and games. So we invite you to attend there and also invite you to put into the chat any ideas you have for other activities you'd like to see us schedule events around. Share your ideas and we'll put our heads together and try to create some different sorts of meetups going forward.
Awesome. And before we have our very last announcements and wind down for, we will have a little bit more after our next song, our next and last song. So stay around. And so Paul, will you take us to our last sing along?
Of course.
Paul, you're muted.
Let's try that. I was wondering if the croquet is going to be hedgehogs and flamingos. Look it up. Song I wrote, I wanna learn it note for note. Don't worry, I'll be happy. Every life we have some trouble, but when you worry, you make it double. Don't worry, I'll be happy. Ain't got no place to lay your head, somebody came, took your bed, but don't worry, be happy. The landlord said the rent is late, you're going to have to litigate, so don't worry, be happy. Here we go. I think think we should sing that again. You all know the words. La 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 la. Got no cash, ain't got no style, ain't got no friends to make you smile, but don't worry, be happy, 'cause when you worry your face will frown, and that will bring everybody down. Song I wrote, I'm glad you learned it note for note. Don't worry, be happy. In your life, expect some trouble, but when you worry, make it double. Don't worry, oh, be happy. Whistle it out. There we go. Otra vez.
Thank you, Paul. So our next assembly will be on Sunday, September 19th. And stay tuned. We have a tentative plan to do this at the venue in person with mandatory masks, even for vaccinated people. And I think everyone that's probably following the news here with Delta, it's really no joke. I know people who work in our hospitals have been seeing more and more people. My job at the county, we thought we were winding down, we're not. And two vaccinated assemblers have already gotten Delta. So we are keeping the option open to do September online if the health requirements for this change on how to do it safely. And if we are in person, we will, we're going to try to have an online option because we're so happy that so many people are able to join from elsewhere. That's one of our silver linings of the pandemic. And so, and that's also why we're doing other events in person outdoors. So, you know, we had that wonderful fireworks and we're going to have the pizza and games at the venue. It's such a lovely space with wonderful outdoor patio and view. And so that's it for the program for today. But if you want to stay after, when we wrap up here, you'll see a little invite on your screen that says go to the breakout room. And so you would do that if you want to ask questions about the VASA and the, with our speaker today. And if you would rather just be in a more general chit chat, you would not join the breakout room, and that will default you into just the general room. And then also if at any time you decide, well, I've had enough of listening about the VASA, et cetera, you can always leave the breakout room. And when you leave room, you're not leaving all of Sunday Assembly, you're just getting defaulted back to the main room. And then at the end of the question and answer with Fred Hocker, there will be another couple minutes for general chit chat for everyone, even the folks who are in that room. And so thank you all so much for coming, and have a wonderful rest of your day. And now we'll open up for those chats.